Well, I was hoping to play golf today. It's been a long time, but basically, the feedback I got from the spiritual intuition is that don't do it. Keep on taping. I said, "Wow, I've been taping a lot," but apparently, it really is go time. We have to really keep pushing this thing. I'm not getting any break at all. I don't feel like I can take any time off. I have to just keep on with pushing this narrative. A lot of there've been a lot of remote viewing of the future, and none of them seem to agree. It seems like there's all these, different outcomes from remote viewing of the future. There's also been time traveling into the future, and that also seems to come up with different outcomes. So, exactly what is going to happen in the future seems to be a riddle locked up in a mystery, locked up in an enigma, you know. I have had significant accuracy in different events, and then also sometimes not. So, I'm not 100% certain exactly what is going to happen. I certainly have been shown a scenario of what's going to happen. I've certainly been taken into the future in spirit somehow, and seen the future. And yet again, it is not set in stone. I cannot say it is absolute. This is absolutely what's going to happen, because there's so many different results that have, people are getting. The way I look at the situation here is, just being here on planet Earth is a complete disaster. We don't need, anything more for it to be a complete disaster. I mean, I can't stand being here on planet Earth. Hate it. Hate vulnerability. Can't stand vulnerability. Having a body means you're vulnerable. Vulnerability. Cannot stand it. It means that other people are vulnerable. Your friends, your relatives, your family members, everybody, every time they go drive a car, they could be hit. You never know. Terrible. And everything changing, everything dying, just the mad scramble for money, and the scarcity, and the illnesses. It is simply a complete nightmare. So the way I look at it is, no matter what happens in the future, makes really doesn't make any fundamental, essential difference whatsoever. This world is always terrible. Never want to come here again, into any form-based world, as it were. So the narrative here, the Passover, is relevant right now. It's relevant any time in the past, and it's relevant any time in the future. Come what may, whatever it comes, the imperative to drop this effort that we're making to try and change reality, which is what existence is. It's an effort to try and change reality. However you slice that pie, it's still, that's what it is. That its purpose remains the same. No matter what angle you have, the purpose, existence has a purpose. Okay, and if you discover that purpose, then see, it does, it's that remains the same, no matter how we confuse ourselves and go into denial and defense, no matter what defenses we're using, etc. Purpose is to try and change reality. Why? Because we want to change what we are. Okay, in reality, what we are is set. Okay, we're an effect of the idea of the Prime Creator. Prime Creator is the cause, we're the effect of that. We complete the cause. And we're spirit. We don't have any form. We're formless. There's no form to what we are. There's just pure pureness, pure experiencing of essence. Doesn't need any form to perceive it, or form to forms. There are no forms in reality, as it were. There's essence. Forms mean made out of energy. Reality is not made out of energy. So we tried to change what we are. We tried to change. He said, we want to be Prime Creator. Let's see if we can be Prime Creator, which means to change reality. In order for us to change what we are, we'd have to change reality. And reality is set for all of reality. There's no exception. So we would have to literally make an exception, change the very nature of reality, and that would mean there'd be no more reality. So, in order to try and change reality, we have dreamed up this scenario of existence, which is constant change, constant loss. And so no matter how you explain it, the purpose is the same. We want to try and change reality. And the fact is, we cannot. Reality can't be changed. That too is a fact. So you have the purpose of trying to change reality, the fact that we cannot change reality. Reality cannot be changed. Therefore, what we're doing is futile. You have, those are facts. No matter what happens in existence, those are still facts. Even if this world goes into a golden age, that's still the facts. Okay, let's say there's no catastrophe, no problem, and we just make a smooth transition into a place where somehow we have, you know, free energy, you name it, free energy, and we can grow enough food and etc. So what? There's no essential difference for me between that time and this time at all. Everything is still vulnerable. Everything is still vulnerable. You still have a body, you know. You can choke on your food. You can fall, have an accident. Lungs fill up with fluid, pneumonia, you die. You know, I mean, the body is an instrument of vulnerability. Who cares if you live in a palace or live in a slum? You have the same vulnerability. Your body has the same vulnerability. Everybody that's ever lived in a palace has also died in many different ways. So, you know, you need to take a break, constantly need to take breath. You're just a couple breaths away from dying. How is that what you really want? The existence can't possibly be what we really want, because we were created in reality to enjoy reality, not to imagine some crazy dream of vulnerability and loss. And we're doing this to try and find a way to change reality. Now, we feel like it's futile. We can't change reality. But what do? Then we say, "Aha! But God can change reality." Okay, that's what we're thinking. The truth is, God cannot change reality. But we believe, well, that must be, since God created reality, God must be able to change it. No. Because God created it to be unchanging. I mean, the way that it is, the freedom, the delight, the spontaneity, the creativity, the direction of creation, the way that it all works is created to not change. God is still going to be the prime creator. And we're trying to be prime creator. God cannot change the fact that God is prime creator. It's not possible. And yet we believe, well, it must be possible because we can't do it. But we want to experience changing reality. So we say, well, the only option, God must be able to do it somehow. It's just that God's not willing to do it. So we believe that we can trick God into it somehow, that we got to find a way. And that's how I say we pad our resume of loss so that we can try to intimidate God. Think, you know what, God, we have this great capacity. We've discovered a power of destruction, of change. Okay, because we show, it's like we're showcasing existence to God. I'm saying, God, look at what we can do, because we're the ones imagining existence. God has nothing to do with existence. Spirit is the one that is using the mind, the creative manifesting aspect of mind, of spirit, which we call mind, to manifest this imaginary scenario, hypothetical imaginary scenario. And we're holding it up like to God, just like a movie, saying, God, look at this, look at what we're able to do. We're able to change everything, no matter what it is. We're able to inflict change on it, and permanent change, in other words, loss, death. Now, of course, in order to put on this display, you know, this vainglorious display, we have to make all these forms. We have to bring all these forms into existence. These bodies, right? These trees, these flora and the fauna and the atmosphere and the planets. We have to imagine all of that, so then we can inflict change and loss upon it and hold this evidence up to God and say, God, look what we can do. This is proof that reality can be changed and we know how to do it. But in the back of our minds, we're saying, we really don't think we can do it, you know. But God must be able to do it. So what we do, we hold all of existence up to God and say, God, we are able to eternally bring about endless change and modification. And you're greater than we are, so surely you can do this too, right? That's another way, kind of approach Prime Creator, saying, look at what we can do. And are you saying you can't do that? You can't change reality at all? The other side is that we try to intimidate Prime Creator and say, Prime Creator, we have this power of change and we're going to inflict change on all of reality. And if you don't like that, we'll make a deal. And if you change a little tiny bit of reality, an infinitesimal little bit, we'll say, okay, that's a deal. We won't inflict change on the rest of reality. Knowing that even the tiniest change in reality would render reality null and void. Okay. And we think, okay, we're something different, because what we were is no longer there, and now we can be something different. This is the deep, 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 deep game that is going on with existence that most of us are unaware of. Most of us are unaware of this. And so I just have to keep, in our ordinary day-to-day functioning, as we go about our day doing various stuff, we're unaware of this. It is super low background, as it were, just a sort of a vague, very deep background kind of dissatisfaction and feeling like we've got to put something over on someone somehow. And we're not really sure, you know, what it is, and yet it's there. And so it's very... takes tremendous determination to fine-tune into this deep, 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 deep on the down-low situation and bring it to light. You have to focus the microscope on it, you know, very carefully. And then you see what the purpose of existence is. Most of us cannot say what the purpose of existence is at all. Most people, you ask them, they say, I have a clue. Isn't that incredible? How could we be here in existence? Here we are and we don't have a clue what our purpose is. How is that possible? How is that possible? What's the purpose of the universe? What's the purpose of existence? You know, we throw all sorts of conjectures up, but there's no conviction to anything that anyone's ever said, I've ever heard. There's no conviction to it. No conviction. If you look at it carefully, you realize it's just a kind of a description of some stuff that they see, and a guess with no real conviction behind it whatsoever. You don't get the conviction by doing it that way. Not at all. So most don't know what the purpose of existence is. Very rare. And I have to discover it on my own, because it's like conviction is lacking in the world. It's so lacking. And you have to see it for yourself, because you can't see it through your perception. You can't see it through perception. If you're just perceiving, you don't have any idea what the world purpose is. All you're thinking about is survival and some contentment and happiness and however you think you can get that, you know, get some more money, basically. Get some more friends. You know, it's either money or networking with friends, or both. And everybody is frantically engaged in that. And what I did was I paid no attention to getting money, no attention to getting friends, none. Completely ignored all that and spent all my time focused in on what is the purpose of existence. Because if you find the purpose, then you say, oh, okay, I can align with that. But that I discovered the purpose of existence is nefarious, you know. I mean, it's literally the attempt to change reality so we can be Prime Creator. And we are deeply, deeply enmeshed in, you know, we're trying to trick God, okay? And we're afraid that if God catches wind that this is a trick, you know, God will say, oh, no, 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 I'm not going to change reality. So we have to pretend like we're not even aware of what we're doing. You know, so God was trying to, we think that God's looking at us, trying to get some clues, like, what is Spirit doing? I'm not sure what Spirit's doing. So Spirit has to pretend like, oh, no, we're just here having fun, you know. That's all, you know, we don't even know what the purpose is. And God, we think that God will say, oh, okay, I don't really know what Spirit's doing. Maybe Spirit's just, you know, having fun. So we pretend like we have no idea what we're doing. We bury it. As if we can't see it, God can't see it. That's kind of the magic we're engaged in. You know, that's a magical thing, right? You think, well, if we just don't see something, then nobody else can see it. You know, the monkey covers their eyes. You think, oh, okay, I can't see. Nobody can see. So if we say we can't see what the purpose of existence is, we then project that and sympathetically, magically believe, oh, well, the prime creator can't see it either. And therefore, the trickeration of it is still, we think it's still in place, you know, as a surprise. We'll trick Prime Creator. But Prime Creator saw the whole thing from the very beginning, from even before, knew exactly what was what. So we're like playing this game of ignorance. We're maintaining our ignorance. It's a willful maintaining of our ignorance. Let's eat, drink, and be merry, you know. Let's not let nobody pay any attention what the real purpose is. Let's all pretend it's something else. So we're all pretending, you know. And I said, well, wait a minute, you know. I don't want to be here in the first place. And I want to know why I'm here. Come on. I don't like this place. I don't like vulnerability. I don't like any of this. I'm tired of it. It's very boring. Come on, let's find out. And people said, no. Let's not go that deep. Let's keep it a little more superficial. So when you're not willing to go all the way to the root, you have defenses against that, and you can throw up all sorts of superficial explanations and paths and practices and focuses. Endlessly. And as we try to get to the root of it, all those diversions and defenses are there. And we have to like struggle through them. It's just awful. Totally awful. Nobody wants to say. And even the teachers, usually they don't say, because they don't want their devotees to freak out and think it's too difficult. They just kind of, they agree with whatever the devotee says. This is what Ananda Mayama did. She, whatever the devotee would say, she'd say, what do you think about the world? What do you know? How do you see things? And the devotee would say, well, I see it this way. And then she would say, you know, that's wonderful. You know, yes. That is a way to see it. Definitely. And then you say, oh, and also, you might also be able to see it this way too, you know. So she'd always agree and reinforce with however anyone saw it, and then say, well, you know, how about also taking a peek over here and trying to get them to start expanding, going deeper. So she didn't just say, look, the purpose of existence is to try to fool God into changing reality. No, didn't do it that way. So you can't take what the gurus say, that type of teacher who is a very one-on-one teacher, took everybody where they were at and then custom-tailored a path for them and helped them take baby steps. So agreeing, yeah, it's like talking with a baby. Yeah, it's a wonderful, you took that little step. Now maybe you think you can take another little step. And let's say the baby said, no, I want to stay right where I am. She'd go, that's wonderful, that's great. Right where you are is wonderful. And, but for me, do you think for me you could take just a little baby step? She's like a mother with a baby, really. like a little toddler, you know. And she, the toddler says, "No, I want to just sit here." And she goes, "Oh, sitting here is great. That's wonderful. Now, maybe can you get up and take a little tiny step for me?" And maybe they would do it, or maybe not. And if they didn't do it, she'd go, "Oh, that's great. That's great. But maybe tomorrow we'll take a little step." So the gurus, it's so hard to get the answer from the gurus, those one-on-one gurus who are doing the mother guru thing, and because they're not going to just directly say that. Maybe if they spoke with me, they'd say it, you know, because I'm ready to hear it. They'd just say, "Yeah, this is it. No problem." But they're not going to say that to, they're going to take their devotees one at a time, wherever they're at. But, you know, that requires extraordinary mothering, as it were. And not all of us are extraordinary mothers, right? That's not the only way to go about it. If you have tremendous determination, absolute urgency, etc., etc., you know, you want to push. And even then, it's difficult. Like, I couldn't get these answers right off the bat. There's way too much defensiveness in the world that you are expected to agree with. It's not that I didn't know. We all know within us the answer. But we have this collective agreement, okay? All aspects of spirit that come into this dream, that try to change reality, have this collective agreement on many, many, many levels. They agree to not get to the root of the situation and see what is there. They say, "Look, you can look anywhere else, but not at the root of it." And so you're battling all through all these agreements, and as you say, "No, I want to go deeper," they'll say, okay, but you need to make some other agreements here. And you keep getting hit with all these legalistic, defensive agreements, and so you need to see it this way, and look at all these wonderful teachers that saw it this way, why don't you go to them? Constant resistance to get to the root of it. And, you know, it's just, I don't know how anybody can do it. My path has just been completely intense, totally off the charts intense. And because they're just, you know, every step you take, there's just an army of resistance rises up and saying, "Go no further. You've done enough." They'll even praise you, saying, "You've done enough. Aren't you wonderful? Why don't you go teach now?" And I say, "How can I teach? I don't know the truth." They say, "Wow, you know, look, you can do it." I say, no, I want to find the real truth. Otherwise, I'm going to have all sorts of problems." So it's a constant effort to keep working. I had a background in previous lives of working on projects for a long, long time, meticulous projects. So it was natural for me to work on something for a long, long time without getting the results that I expected. That was something I've already trained in. You know, it was just super great training. Because in order to get to the root of the problem here, you literally have to spend like a lifetime at it, tell you the truth. Now, I know that there are people saying there's easier ways. Maybe there are, but the bottom line is you do have to get to the bottom of it at some point. Now, maybe, you know, there are some that say, well, there's a happy way. A Course in Miracles says there's a happy, joyful way to go along the path. And to be perfectly honest, I don't exactly understand that way, because that's not the way that I took. I don't know. But, you know, I have to give the benefit of the doubt to the author of the Course, saying that there is a joyful way. It seems to be somehow to be in relationships and to be in a happy relationship and share goals and something like that. But again, the Course also says that's just one of thousands and thousands and thousands of ways to do it, really. So many different ways. And so for my way was not joyful. It was struggling. And many go that way, struggle and use clarification and listen to reason and follow the guidance, the inner guidance of clarification, and keep clarifying every day working hard. And Ananda Mahima said that that is what everyone does have to do, is work extremely hard every day. There's no way around it. Ramana Maharshi said the same thing. Until you realize the self, abide in the self, you really do have to work very hard to get past these, you know, defenses. Well, you know, people call them different things. All these defenses that you've put up to obscure the purpose of existence, to obscure it. We've tried to make it totally obscure. Again, thinking if we can't see it, Prime Creator can't see it. That is the madness that we've been engaged in. So we are in a, existence is totally fuzzy. It's super difficult to bring it into focus because we have put it all out of focus, you know? We have intentionally obscured the purpose. And anytime we start to look there, we have all this suddenly defensives rise up and say, no, this is taboo, don't look there. What are you doing? You're crazy, you go totally crazy. It's not true. That is not true. Every step of the way, as you try to go deeper, there's all this pressure on you saying, if you look there, you're going to go completely insane. Not true. Not true. We don't look within to see the purpose of existence because we think that if we can't see it, Prime Creator can't see it. And if Prime Creator can't see it, then we stand a very good chance of getting Prime Creator to agree to our deal and to change reality, which means that we can change what we are and we can be Prime Creator, hypothetically. It's all hypothetical. We are simply entertaining a hypothetical, which is different than entertaining an idea. The idea of changing reality is, it's a hypothetical. It's kind of like the idea of hypotheticalness is really what it is. And we were not created to live in the idea of hypotheticalness, okay? We're free. We're perfectly free, so we can try to do that. But it's not what we really want, because what we really want is innate within us. It is part of us. It is our being. We can't change it. So no matter what we do with existence, it will never be what we really want. Never. I guarantee you that. Go on that as cornerstone. It will never be what we really want. So we keep throwing up all the stuff trying to find what we think we want. Oh, we think we want this, we think we want that, and we keep pursuing all the stuff we think we want and acquiring and accumulating it, whatever it may be. And ultimately in existence, it's loss, it's suffering, it's misery, it's devastation. It's evidence that what hypothetically is can be destroyed, can be changed, can be wiped out. And that we don't really want it. We don't really want that, no matter, again, whether we're happy, pleasure, or whether we're sad, in pain, whether we're living in existence or dying, dead. The whole gamut of hypothetical experiencing existence will never be what we really want. Never. Because what we really want is reality. Not hypothetical, but reality. Actual isness, being, essence, direct, pure experiencing. That is what we really want. Carefree, eternal delight. Can't even remember that. But that is what we really want, and it'll always be what we really want. We will never be satisfied with whatever arises in existence. Never. It's impossible. So what's the point of it then? What's the point of continuing on with existence? So what's being talked about here is to free yourself from existence, which means all the cycles of existence, which means being born, living you know, in existence, and then dying, being dead, the afterlife, all of that stuff, getting free of all of it. Because dying, the death of a body doesn't, is not the end of the cycles of existence. Existence is the whole energy construct is existence. And that's on many levels, all sorts of different gradations of that. And you just simply transit from one energy level to another, to another, to another, to another, and you cycle back and find yourself, you know, going up, subtler, and then coming back down to the grosser over and over and over. This is well documented, well testified to by those who have seen the whole situation. So what we're talking about here is getting free of that entire energy construct, which is a hypothetical construct, the entire hypothetical construct, freeing ourselves from that so we can get back to what we really want. That is the whole point of this. We're not trying to live in a body forever here on this planet, like, oh, we're immortal here. That's the craziest thing ever. Who in the world would ever pursue such a goal? You know, I gotta shake my head, you know, when I hear, oh yeah, somebody has attained immortality here, and they're in the body, and now they can live here in this world forever. And it's like, ah, you know, that's like the ultimate booby prize, isn't it? That's the ultimate thing you don't want to do. You don't want to pursue that. Because in reality, you don't have any form at all. You're formless. The experiencing is direct. It is, you know, it's not going through a form. It's not going through a type of perception. It is a spontaneous expansion of creativity that is directly known and felt. No intermediary, no of a body, of a perception, none whatsoever. And there's zero vulnerability, no body, no energy constructs whatsoever. So that is what we really want. So the notion of, you know, let's make this world a better place, that is crazy. You know, that is what is crazy, is thinking that you're going to find something you really want in existence. That is true insanity. That is crazy. So when people say, if you look within, you're going to go crazy, what they're really worried about is if you look within and see the purpose of existence, you'll realize that they're crazy. That is the truth of the matter. I've never gone crazy at all. What I've seen is that the world is insane, and that people, those in the, who are thinking that they can get what they really want in existence are, you know, foolish. They're pursuing a completely crazy path that will never satisfy them. When you look within and see it, you're just calm. You say, oh, aha, now I see. Good, 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 good. Great. I think now there's a way to escape this. Get free of it. And of course there is. There is, by choosing a different idea. Instead of choosing the idea of trying to change reality, choose the idea of not trying to change reality. And that also probably is a hypothetical. But it's a hypothetical that is not trying to pass itself off as anything other than a hypothetical. It goes nowhere. It's like a mirror. See, a mirror is not reality. What you're seeing in a mirror is a reflection. It's not the real thing, right? But the mirror is not trying to change or distort or obscure, you know, anything. It's just trying to give a pure reflection, as it were. So the idea of not trying to change reality, that's still a hypothetical. Why would anyone choose that idea? Unless we had first chosen the idea of trying to change reality. Then it provides the remedy. Because you're not trying to change anything. You're not trying to lose anything. You get a pure reflection then of reality. You can get a pure feeling of it. And yet it's still is a hypothetical, but it's the last hypothetical you need. It's using a hypothetical to remove a hypothetical. Okay. Like, what if we decided not to change reality? What would that be like? Well, you'd have a perfect reflection of reality. You wouldn't be directly experiencing it, right? But you'd have a reflection of it, pure reflection. I call it an overlay, as it were. Unconditional love, just this perfectly calm, pure overlay. And then you'd feel, reality, you'd realize reality can't be changed. And this is what I really want. It's what I really want. So we have to be guided by, be attracted to, back to reality. We have to really realize, we have been pursuing what we think we want, what we believe we want, but it's not what we really want, and we have a right to what we really want and to follow that attraction. So when I had a glimpse of reality, I immediately realized that's what I really want. Immediately, it was like, it was it occurred simultaneously with experiencing reality. Was the simultaneous realization, this is what I really want. And then from that point on, it's a matter of being attracted back to it, and that gives rise to determination and effort. And was able to distinguish between what I believe I want, think I want, and what I really want. They're different. It's different. What we think we want is we think we want to find a way to change reality. And what we really want is to realize reality cannot be changed. So, very different. Opposite directions. Okay. Opposite directions. So, when we're oriented towards what we really want, we're certainly going to go in the opposite direction of the purpose of existence. Can't be otherwise. Because if we're pursuing both, each one is like canceling the other out. And we don't really want that either. You know, to get absolutely nowhere, we don't want that. And so we go through a period of kind of stagnation where we're trying to pursue both of these simultaneously. And we feel stagnated. And then gradually the emphasis becomes on what we really want, and the stagnation feels less and less and less and less and less, but there's still some. I went through a long period of stagnation. It's called the dark night of the soul, where you feel like you're getting nowhere because you're giving up full-on pursuit of what you think you want, and you're pursuing what you really want, but you're kind of not totally into either one. You're not really sure, and you kind of vacillate. And as you vacillate, you don't feel like you're getting anything that you want. And I've been through that, definitely. So, there is that period of time which is very difficult, extremely difficult, which is why I say that as far as where you want to find yourself in existence, you should aim to find yourself in a place where there's tremendous support for the spiritual path, because you are going to find it very difficult. I know A Course in Miracles says there's an easy, happy way, etc. But also in other places it says you're going to go through all sorts of phases, and some of them will be very difficult too. So there's no way around it, because you're transiting from what you think you want to what you really want. And you're going to go through a period where you're not sure, you know, you're not totally committed to either, right? You're not totally committed to either. And then you get into stagnation. And you need support for that. You need support for it. Super important to find yourself in a culture that is based on the spiritual path, this, and recognizes the difficulty of it, and recognizes that as you go through this changeover from what you think you want to what you really want, you will feel that it's okay. That a lot of others are going through the same thing, and you're not getting behind, as it were, because it's super difficult in the modern world, especially the Western world, super difficult, the spiritual path, super difficult. Because everybody here is frantically pursuing what they think they want, and we have made it possible for all sorts of goodies to come in, so everybody thinks they're getting what they want. Lots of it. And if you're on the path to going toward what you really want and letting go of pursuing what you think you want, you're not getting anything coming in, really. And so you feel like you're being left behind, severely left behind. And it's brutal, just brutal. Whereas like in a place like India or all the sadhus, you know, they're surrounded by thousands, hundreds of thousands, and even millions of other people who are not trying to really get anything what they think they want. They're not really getting anything. They just have their, you know, minimum, their a shawl, a loincloth, a staff, or a bowl, you know, just whatever they can carry with them. And they're not acquiring anything in life. They're not, you know, so they can sit in meditation for 30 years and not acquire anything and still not feel that they're being left behind, left in the dust, you see? So that makes it so much easier. Unbelievable. In the modern Western world, it is simply devastating to be left in the dust of progress. And, you know, see, you know, you got a car and the car's wearing out. You can't afford new tires for it. You know, the radiator goes out. You need the engine, the valve job. Turn signals go out. Everything in the car starts falling apart and you can't afford it, a new one. And then you realize you're driving this old car on the freeway and people are going, you know, in their brand new cars. Everybody has brand new cars. And you feel like totally unsafe driving this old, you know, rickety car. Nightmare. I've been through all of that. It's incredibly stressful. You know, your house, everything's falling apart, everyone's remodeling, everything's changing, everyone's getting new clothes constantly. They're go, push as fast as possible. New stuff. They're trying to get what they want, they think they want this, they think they want that, advertising. And if you're just not doing any of that, you know, you're not pushing it, you'll find yourself at the bottom of the heap with nothing. And the whole system is not geared for that at all. So it is simply a nightmare to take the spiritual path, and that's why many are not succeeding. They're not succeeding, you know. It's just they're not getting to the bottom of it. Because how can they get to the bottom of it and at the same time keep up with the Joneses and not feel like they're just totally out of it? You know, I used to stay in my room for like a week at a time, month at a time, not even go out, go anywhere. And when I go out, I would be completely shocked. I say, everything's changed. You go into a store, they restock the store, constantly restocking. And in stores, they even are continuously changing the layout of the store. So when you go in, it all looks different. I remember I brought my uncle into like a Home Depot, various stores, and he hadn't been in those stores for years and years and years. And he just looking like this, and it was like he was in a different planet. Couldn't believe it. He couldn't recognize anything. And if you just stay out of a store for like a couple months, you go in there and you say, oh my gosh, everything's new. They changed the packaging on everything. It's unbelievable. Again, constant new models of cars coming out. And, you know, you look at your car and you say, you know, wow, everything in the car's changed. You know, so many different things. Just the grind of functioning, so you're not a danger to others in this world. If you're driving some, as a squirrel, some whole old jalopy, you're a danger to other drivers. You know, sure, I'm on the freeway, and there's somebody in their car driving 45 miles an hour. You know, and you're like, whoo, you got to slam on the brakes. You got to try to swerve around them. You know, it's dangerous. So, in this Western world, we do not allow for people to drop out. Really, we do not allow for it. You're expected to keep up with the pace until you drop dead, basically. And if you're fortunate, you have a family that takes care of you when you get old, you're very fortunate. If not, you get, you know, tossed into some, well, God even knows. I mean, if you don't have any medical insurance, you don't even have any assisted living insurance, you basically got to go until you drop. And you'll end up, a lot of people end up with nothing, and they just beg for alcohol. Okay, I give money to the guys, and I did this one time. I was giving money and food and all sorts of survival stuff to someone who was injured. I was injured on the job, had no insurance, nothing, had no means of support, no family, and they were just on the street, and I was supporting them, and I gave them money, and I watched one time where they went. I just was saying, let me see. I had a suspicion. Went straight to a liquor store, spent all the money on liquor, and just, you know, drank it into oblivion. They just want oblivion, right? And they just keep bringing oblivion to themselves until their body dies. And eventually, he did die. He was taken to the emergency room many times. In horrible condition. Oh my gosh. I just saw how the body is living. He was a living corpse. Everything infected, everything rotting. It was just horrible. You know, they just drink alcohol to just knock out the pain, right? How could I blame him? I didn't blame him. I didn't get angry with him. It was ghastly. That's what happens if you don't go full in on trying to grab some piece of the pie, some money, fight for it. You know, I mean, the politics in workplaces are intense. Everybody is working angles. Everybody's desperately trying to get something so that at least when they get old and can't fight for themselves any longer, they might be able to sit in a bed and watch television, you know, in some assisted living place like a zombie, and get some medications to kill the pain of whatever's, you know, suffering they're having. And I've been in many assisted living places, many. I used to volunteer there, and it's horrible. You know, they do the best they can, but everybody's just like, they're like wiped out, you know, because they've been fighting, and they're, it's like they've been on the battlefield their whole lives, and now they're the casualties, and they're just, you know, and they're just on, like, you know, 10 different medications, all sorts of stuff. Some of them on heavy painkillers. And they get up in the morning, eat some breakfast, and then they go back in their bed and watch television. You know, just television's always on. Even the best people end up there. My uncle ended up there. One of the best people you can ever walk the face of this earth ended up there. No matter what we did, it's horrible. And another uncle was fortunate enough to have a family that helped out, as this one did not have family. And or, you know, you do. Some just go until they just get some real bad illness that, boom, kills them real quick. But how many turn their backs on pursuing what they think they want and make that transition to what they really want? How many? My gosh, it's extreme rarity. My situation was extremely rare, and I don't recommend it for anybody, but somehow I've survived to this point through the help of my family. Otherwise, no way would I have survived, because there's no cultural support for this process that you need to go through. is transiting from what you think, pursuing what you think you want, to moving towards what you really want. There is that transiting time, and this culture makes no allowances for that whatsoever. Zero. So I say it's an absolutely brutal regime right now. Last 50 years, 55 years I've been here, it's a completely brutal regime already. So people talk about the future being really brutal, which I believe it will be. There's every indication it will be, because it's becoming exponentially more brutal all the time. Every day we take more and more steps into, you know, more regimentation, more push towards what we think we want. Not less, more, way more. And that makes the spiritual path more and more difficult, incredibly more difficult. What we're going towards is a dead end, a little dead end, because all the policies that are being put in place are putting the burden of supporting elder people who are wiped out from their push. I mean, the push, people don't realize it, that the push that they're putting themselves under now just to keep up with the Joneses and not, you know, be in the gutter, is wiping them out stress-wise. Again, I talked to a doctor who said that he's seeing patients now with stress syndromes, problems, he said, you never used to see in young people, only older people. Now, younger people are having this all the time because they're pushing themselves. How? Through caffeine, caffeination, stimulation of all types. Just frantically pushing ourselves, you know. And what's going to happen is our health's going to break down. The generations that are going through this, the baby boomers, you know, they're going to find that their health, all sorts of health problems. And then from then on, the generations more recent, they're going to find themselves by the time they hit 50, they're going to be finished, you know, because of all the drugs and stimulants and the way they push themselves. So they may need, you know, socialized medical care for 30 years. So this entire plan to try and take care of us in our later years, all of that is being put on the backs of the younger people. And they're going to have to work 10 times harder to pay for all this. Who's going to pay for the Social Security, for all the medical, socialized medical care? Who's going to pay for all of that when you get all these people retiring and getting sick and not able to work anymore? The people who can work are going to be worked 10 times harder, which means they have to come up with all more ways to drive their nervous systems, all sorts of antidepressants. Already that's happening, where 1 in 10 people are on antidepressants, I think, maybe more. The pharmaceutical industry will keep these people just pumped with stuff, steroids, you name it, to keep them working like super people, just to keep generating enough stuff, enough income, all this, you know, enough to pay for all the care of these older people who are wiped out. See, it didn't used to be that way. With a much lower stress level in the past, people either they'd get sick and die of cancer like that, or a heart attack, whatever, or they live a long life, like 80 or 90, 100, pretty darn healthy. I mean, some of the older generation were very healthy until they hit, you know, their 90s or so. And even then, they could, you know, didn't need a lot of care. Nowadays, again, we're having systemic illnesses that are illnesses of stress that break our body down, and we're going to be end up in these assisted living situations for a long time, pumped full of drugs. It's horrible. So you have a dead end. What I mean by that is the laws of the land will be such that we're required, the young people will be required to slave away to support the older people. So many needing extended, very expensive medical treatments, extended help, and many people will go on disability. The pace will break them down. So we have a huge number of people on disability, huge number of people who need assisted living for a long period of times, huge number of people who need extensive medical procedures and tremendous pharmaceutical treatments for their systemic chronic illnesses. All that put on the backs of young, healthy people. What do you think is going to happen? Okay. The younger people will have not a second to consider maybe dropping the pursuit of what they think they want. And legally, it will be impossible. It will be legally a crime to do so. It will be absolutely a crime. I'm seeing all these laws are pinning us all in to basically being slaves on a plantation, as it were. No question about it. So that's why I'm saying it's a dead end. When you reach that point, it's a dead end. And there will be like a revolt. There will be, the young people will say, oh my gosh, we're trapped. And they're gonna say, we're not gonna do this. Yeah. What then? You see all these revolutions in the Mediterranean area, the Middle East, North Africa, Middle East. You see all these revolutions. The young people are saying, "Hey, you know, we're not going to spend our whole lives slaving to simply support the older people. We want a regime change, total regime change. So you have a revolution." Or if you're really pinned down, the collective will, the young people say, let this, forget it, this is a dead end, let's collapse the whole thing, and let's, you know, and let everybody starve, and let the survival of the fittest, let's go back to survival of the fittest. There's a strong push to that in the young. See, you have to read the whole situation, read the young people. They're being led in, you know, they're being trapped into this dead end. And of course, nobody wants that. And so there, the attitude, what's the attitude? Is it just passively, okay, we're going to be good little sheep and go along? Or is there this collective will saying, wait a minute, let's just collapse the whole thing? And they can do it. Revolutions succeed because it's the young people who have tremendous will and determination and intensity of desire. They overwhelm the older generations. They overwhelm them. So when I talk about likely collapse coming, you know, we say, well, it's the elites. No, the elites want the slave system to continue. It's the younger people who are going to collapse the situation. How they do that, I say they're going to booby trap the software of finances. And we saw that recently, that Knight, who had software that enabled transactions to take place, market transactions to take place. Well, there were bugs in the software which, like, basically caused them to, you know, malfunction and would have destroyed the company. They've got some white knight came along and kept them from going under. And it's interesting that Batman movie was the Knight something, and then the software bug in this company named Knight, you see. So what I have said is there is this plan by younger people. It's not the old oligarchy, okay? Those are not the ones who are going to collapse it, because they want it to keep going because it's working for them. They don't want to collapse the system. And they're already old and they're going to die, so they just say, hey, we want to just keep this going as long as we live. It's the younger people who realize that they're entrapped. They are entrapped in this dead end of them simply being driven like slaves to pay for all these social programs and all the social welfare and all this disability and all this stuff. And they realize by the time they hit 50, they're going to be walking corpses. They're going to be burned out. And it's obvious what's going on. And so they say, hey, you know, we don't want to live this way. And we're young enough that we think we can survive a collapse. And we want to remake the whole situation differently. And if it means that all the older people die off, fine, because they're trying to kill us anyway, tell you the truth. And So what I have seen happening is what they are going to do, younger people, their 20s, teens, 20s and 30s, the ones who write all the software, have a plan to, there's a plan to, for all the software that runs all the financial markets to malfunction and to cause a complete market collapse through high technology, through software. So I said this over my other channel, Clarity Ross channel, about what I saw happening. As I saw the sudden collapse of the entire Wall Street. How is that possible? Through software bugs. That's how it's possible. Or hacking it, hacking the computer systems. And these younger people, they're the ones who made these systems. They know the flaws. They know the vulnerabilities, you see. And if there's enough collective will among the young people, that will happen. It will happen because the desire and will literally makes the pathway to make it happen. So the real revolution that's coming is the collapse of Wall Street, which means the collapse of money, the collapse of everything. The whole civilization will collapse. And will that happen? I don't know for 100% certainty, but that's how I see the likelihood, because we are at a dead end. We're at a dead end. And this is something that is felt. Doesn't matter if I say it or not, it's something that is felt. People are saying, oh, no, wait a minute, you know. I'm supposed to what? I'm supposed to be in this rat race and give it everything I got, and then by the time I'm 50, I'm burned out. They say, oh, I'll retire at 50. But what they're seeing is, wait a minute, by the time I'm 50, I'm going to have some, you know, osteoarthritis. I'm going to have a chronic heart problem. I'm going to have high cholesterol. I'm going to have diabetes. I'm going to have this and this and this and that. And I'm not going to be able to enjoy my retirement. Plus, I have to push it off on the younger generations. We're in a dead-end spiral, the way that we've pursued things. By pursuing what we think we want, we've got ourselves into this dead end. And the young people may not say much about it, but that's, see, the young people are very sneaky. Okay, we know that. We've all been young. They can be extraordinarily sneaky. I mean, they can invent entire languages and way of communicating that the older people don't even know what they're talking about. Certain nuances, just the whole, they're able to advance a narrative of their own where the older generations have no idea what the narrative is they're advancing. They're able to do it. They've always done it. Young people can always do that. And they're able to overthrow regimes that seem impenetrable. I mean, look at the Libyan regime. Look at the Syrian regime. Look at the Egyptian regime. Look at these regimes that seemed, you know, impenetrable. And now, gone with the wind, almost, you know. In Syria, you know, not quite yet. But young people are able to penetrate any defenses that the old regime has and overthrow them. That is the testimony of history from time immemorial. So to think that in today's day and age that's not possible is ludicrous. It's crazy to believe that. And we think, no, we've got all this sophistication now, all these safeguards, etc., etc. Yeah, but who made all this stuff? Young people did. They're the ones who did all this stuff. You get these 16-year-olds who are hacking into the most secure computer systems in the world. You know? So it is lunacy to think that somehow this worldwide regime that we have, which is imprisoning young people into this, you know, terrible, something that they don't really want at all. It's lunacy to think that they won't find a way to bring it down, bring this regime down. Could be some 16-year-old will bring it down, you know? Are a group of them. And they're, look at the WikiLeaks thing, look at the Anonymous, look at all this stuff. And they have ways to do it. So what I saw in a vision, I saw that there's a sophisticated plan that involves different countries. I saw where it's coming from. And it has to do with the software and the computer systems that are running the world right now, running the world. The whole financial world is run on computer systems. And it had to do with somehow tricking these computer systems into messing up and going haywire, going crazy. Basically, they're able to make the whole network of computers that are running the financial system go crazy. And then the whole thing, our whole financial system, which is run on computers, collapses. And then the collapse of civilization. So I'm not backing away from what I said on my other channel, Clarity Ross. It seems like almost inevitable because of the burden, brutal burden we've placed on the young people, you know? Because we haven't taken care of our health. Why? Because we've been pursuing material goals and materiality of frantically pursuing a new car every 3 years. My God. I know people get a new car every year. I know people, you know, they have 3 cars. You know, the newest one, boom, they got it. Boom, they got it. Constantly taking them to be serviced. New tires, boats, you know. Whatever, houses all over the place. Everybody's pursuing that. Got to get it. You know, we got to get a swimming pool. We got to get this. We got to get that. Frantically clawing their way, you know, up the ladder of success, trying to just get a hold of a little bit more, burning themselves out, their health collapsing. And yet we have all these medications that can keep us alive, right? In the past, you'd be dead. I mean, how much of the population right now is alive only because they're on all sorts of medications and procedures? A lot. In the past, let's say if there were no more medications in the world, for example, none, how many people would die because of that? Maybe 1 billion, 2 billion, who knows? Probably in the billions of people would die if there was no more medications in the world. Rapidly, they would die. So we have artificially boosted the population of the planet up. And therefore, there's more competition for what we think we want. And so there's more stress. So the stress levels are off the charts, getting worse every day. And that breaks you down. I know. I've been through it. Breaks you down horribly. Kills you. And then, you know, your blood pressure is through the roof. Everything goes haywire. And so the young people are looking at the system and saying, this is crazy. And they expect us to keep everything afloat? Wow. You know, wait a minute. We don't want this. And what do we do about it? It's locked in. The laws, you know, everything's locked in. Nothing we can do about it. They say, well, okay, how about just overthrowing the whole regime? And, you know, they haven't got what they wanted yet, you see. With this present administration, didn't give them what they want. Didn't give regime change at all. Just the opposite. So I expect that at some point, the computer systems will go crazy. And there's another thing, is that a lot of these young people come from subtler energy realms where they use mind power, okay? Have all sorts of psychic powers. They're able to influence things mentally, okay? They have all sorts of ways to do it that we don't even are hardly aware about, the older generation. Psychokinesis, just one thing, but there's all sorts of quantum powers, abilities that they are aware of and know how to use, which means they can there find ways to do it. They can even time travel and bring it about. So the computer systems that the whole world is running on make us incredibly vulnerable. And the young people, sensing they're in a dead end, you know, will do what they always do. They'll do something about it. Look at the Chinese Revolution, the Communist Revolution, the Mao Revolution, as young people who felt they were at a dead end. Look at the Bolshevik Revolution, again, young people. People who felt they were at a dead end. Look at the revolutions throughout history. It is the young people who push the revolutions. Now, sure, there are middle-class bureaucrats, etc., like in the Bolshevik Revolution. It wasn't all just youth. But the youth supply the driving force to it. They supply this intense energy, willful energy. I remember Arnold Palmer, a great golfer, he was interviewed and he explained how he played golf. He said, I play golf through my mental will. I will the ball to go where I want it to go. Now, it doesn't always go where I want it, but he said, it's not my physical body that's doing it. It's my mind that's doing it. And he had the tremendous will. Some of those who succeed at the highest level have this enormous will power. And that literally bends time and space. Our desire and our will and our focus concentrate bends time and space a little bit, greater or lesser extents. And a group of young people who have tremendous psychic powers can literally cause changes that we don't realize they can do. And right now, we are at a dead end. That is true. You know, there's no point in denying it. It's true. Socially, we're at a dead end. Just the sheer facts of the situation, the demographics are inescapable. The whole thing, the debt, everything is inescapable. And any intelligent person can see this. And the older people will just say, well, yeah, but, you know, I'm going to die, you know, in 10 years anyway. So I think we could keep it going for at least 10 years. And even older people say, well, I'll be dead in 2 years, 3 years. So they don't care. And if you're like my age, 55, say, well, if we can keep it going maybe for 20 more years, you know, maybe I'll, you know, get to 75 and then I'll be dead. But the younger people say, wait a minute. I've got like 60 years ahead of me, maybe 65 years. And this is what I have to look forward to. I'm supposed to be the one that solves all this debt and somehow props up all these sick people, all these older people who can't work anymore. What do you think their attitude is going to be? They're going to say, hey, no way. No way. They're not going to say, yeah, I can just get by 10 more years. That'll be fine. No, 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 no. They say, wait a minute. No way, you see. So you have to look at the big picture, the demographics, the aging, the debt, the being able to keep people alive for long periods of times where in the past they would be dead, all the stress-based illnesses, the pace of life, the amount of stress, the whole picture. And then the young people with their psychic abilities and tremendous capability to focus. And they're the ones who've set up all the software and the systems, et cetera, et cetera. You know, you just look at that picture and you would have to put a probability on the situation that they are probably going to crash the system and flip the regime. Because they say, you know, this is hell for us. We're, you know, if we can do something about it, we will. That's the youth, right? The older people, they say, no, I'm too old and too tired. I can't change anything. I'm just going to try to get by. But when you're young, you say, hey, I can change the world. Right? That is always young people say, we want to change the world. We can change the world. But if you look at it now, you see it's a dead end. So changing the world means collapsing and starting anew, as it were. And again, young people won't let older people know what they're doing. They won't. They don't. It's secret. It's like a secret society. Generations have their own secret society and they have their own agenda, and it's secret. Nobody's supposed to know about it. You know, I know about it because I'm also sensitive and a psychic and all this stuff, and I'm also aware of dreams. I'm able to see what's going to happen. I've been a precognitive my whole life, and so I saw what's going on the subtle levels. And I just said, wow, whoa, what is this, you know? And I've been able to gradually, you know, piece it together. It's very difficult. I don't think there's hardly any older people that, very few who are aware of what's taking place with the younger people. because it's a whole different ballgame. And they don't really want anybody in on their game, which I think is they're here to be game changers. They want to change this whole thing. Now, they elected the present administration. They put the present administration in place because they thought this present administration was going to be, you know, regime changer, and it turned out not to be. It turned out just the opposite. Putting all the socialized stuff, putting massive burden on the younger people. And so the younger people are furious at this, really. Really, they won't say so, but they say, hey, you know, it's in our hands now. At some point, they're going to say, you know what? We need this, our future, to be in our hands. Okay, can't trust the older people. Because, you know, when you hit 50, what are you thinking? You're thinking retirement. You're thinking about how can I get to retirement? How can I get as much as possible in my hands now? Whereas, and so what they're doing is they're simply mortgaging the future for their own comforts and putting that mortgage onto their children and grandchildren. It's exactly what's taking place. And so the young people are saying, hey, wait a minute, this isn't regime change, this is just more of the same. So they're not saying anything, but they're, I'm sure, that they are working on their remedy. Definitely. Why did this night firm have all these software bugs that just crashed their whole firm, you know? What destroyed them? Basically, they did collapse, and they're being propped up now. There's been all sorts of banking collapses in the world recently. In Europe, of course, in the U.S., all those investment firms, et cetera, terrible collapse. And Europe, actually, Europe banking system collapsed, but it's being propped up by all sorts of, you know, financial medicines. Really, the world's finances are on heavy medication. This is the truth. Just like we, a sick person, you know, you have high blood pressure, high cholesterol, diabetes, arthritis, okay? You're on all these medications and you're still functioning and you're still doing stuff, and people look at you and say, oh, they seem okay, but you're on heavy medication. So the banking, the world financial system is on heavy medication, financial medication. You know, Europe has just been going through this roller coaster trying to stabilize the medications, the financial medications that they're on. But they're under heavy medication. They're very sick. So it's like this: the regime is crumbling. It's crumbling. And it's on strong medication. It wouldn't take much more to, you know, knock it out. And I believe the younger generations will do that. And which leaves the older generations out of luck. You know, really, seriously. That's what I've seen. Put them in camps, rationing, food rationing, rationing of everything, and survival of the fittest, survival of the fittest. And the young people feel they can survive a regime change, they can survive a collapse of civilization, they can survive it. And, you know, they're probably right, some of them can. What they don't realize is that there's a greater collapse coming after that from other places who want who have different, you know, want to bring about a whole planetary sacrifice. So they're not aware of that. Their goal is to bank, you know, have the world financial system just simply collapse, everyone in paralysis, and reboot it, restart it with them in charge. With them in charge. This is the apocryphal prophecies of Christianity, that there's going to be an Antichrist coming to the world. First, there'll be a complete financial collapse, economic collapse, world paralysis, and then someone will come up with the answer. You know, say, hey, folks, this is how we're going to do it. And, yeah, that's very likely to happen. I believe it will happen. And it'll be a whole different ballgame, and, you know, the older people will basically die off. It'll be a young person's game. And they're you know, willing, they're saying, their attitude is, hey, you're willing to put us into, our whole lives into bondage to just take care of you, make give you comfortable 80 years. So you're willing to enslave us, so why should we... Shouldn't we be willing to, you know, cut your rope, you know, and cut you loose and let you fend for yourself, you know? That's how they feel. They feel, hey, you're basically willing to enslave us, so why should we care about you? what happens to you. That's the underlying attitude. Again, I've spoken with this about this at length over at the Clarity Ross channel, that the attitude I get from the younger people, again, I'm a very sensitive being, to the point where I've been able to understand the very purpose of existence. And what the attitude I get, the readings, I'm very observant, and I just quietly observe, is that younger people, they're going to cut the older people loose, and they're out of luck. One second here, I gotta take a break here because someone's gonna come here. All right, pardon the interruption there. The younger people look at the older people as if they're already dead. They've already decided that, you know, we're not going to take care of you. That is definitely the feeling I get. You know for a fact, I know people who live in cultures where it's absolutely a given that the younger people will take care of the older people. Get like the Philippines, for instance. It's an absolute given. The older people never have to worry about their later years. The children, their relatives will take care of them, period. It's a complete obligation. Contrast that now here. And is that attitude there? Not at all. If you look at the younger people, you can sense, is their will and heart in it to take care of me for 20, 30 years when I get older and can't work anymore? Is that there? It's easy to test it. You know, is it there? And you realize it's not there. They're not going to do it. Absolutely not. They say, you're on your own. You are on your own, buddy. And so, you know, obviously they've got an agenda in mind. See, you can tell that they have definitely, it's like you're already dead to them. You know, already dead to them. They're not going to take care of the older people, which is a drastic change throughout history. Throughout history, younger people have always taken care of the older people. That has been civilization. So when we talk about, you know, incredibly drastic change in civilization, it's the younger people decide we're no longer going to take care of the older people. You're out of luck because you've put too much burden on us. You're out of luck. You've broken the social contract. You know, and I'm not judging them. I don't say I blame them, you know, because really, literally, this pursuit of materiality has put the burden on them. There's no question that it's true. It's a vicious thing. Vicious situation we've got ourselves in because we've been pursuing what we think we want and we've been led down the primrose path and now we're going to pay the price. Whereas in my case, I didn't do that. I realized it from the very beginning. No, don't go down this way. Pursue spiritual truth. Pursue what you really want. instead of what you think you want. And, you know, I don't know what my future is going to be. I certainly don't expect anyone's going to take care of me, that's for sure. Not in this world. So I'm hoping to translate into another place. Like I said, the paradise realm, by applying the Passover principle, by being willing to be attracted to what I really want, you see, being aligned towards that. I see that is essential, because in this world, like I said, if you're an older person in this world, you may be out of luck very soon, very soon. There's nothing I can do about it, you know. It'll be a total paralysis. What I saw was a total paralysis of this world as the financial system completely collapsed like that. All distribution, commerce, distribution, everything was paralyzed. And people were still alive, and yet they said, we can't move, we can't get anything, we can't do anything. So, you know, at that point in time, you have just those who are super capable survivalists, basically finding some way to survive, and the older people, just, you know, they're out of luck, totally. And that's how I read the tea leaves, you know. Just, and I think there's an extremely strong case for that. And I've actually seen this is what's going to happen. Before I even made this case, I saw what was going to happen. Then I said, how is this possible? How is this possible? And now I see the case that is there. The case is there. And, you know, older generations have always trusted younger generations because they're not putting the total, you know, stream burden on them. In fact, they're passing on their wealth and a lot of stuff to them, you know. Nowadays, it's the older generation says, yeah, you know, you have to work yourself to death just so I can live my rest of my years in comfort and happiness, etc. And younger people say, oh, no. There's not the respect. There's not the love between generations. Compared to what it used to be, are you kidding? When my uncle, you know, needed me, I dropped everything. I did everything I could to help him out. Everything I possibly could. I felt obligated, you know. I put my own interests, forget about him. You know, he's old, he needs help, he's a good, great guy, help him out. My dad got sick, you know, do everything you can. You know, there's obligation, do everything you can to help him. And nowadays, is that really there? Is there that love and obligation from the generations, like an 80-year-old person and a 20-year-old? The 20-year-old is going to say, yeah, I'll take care of them or something. That's going the way of the dodo bird. I don't feel it at all. If it was there, it would be felt. Now, there is a very... Now, I've talked about how this world is being desensitized to all this violence and suffering and misery, etc. There's a purpose to that. Is we may look at around the world, and the things that I've said may seem to be extreme, yet what has happened is people have been desensitized to brutality, desensitized to violence, to extreme brutality, extreme control. So when it comes, they'll kind of say, oh, you know, that's no big deal. So that is the trick. I talked about the etheric parasites, vampires, etheric vampires, how they want to enslave the planet, and they want to constantly stimulate us into fear and all this terrible stuff, and yet things still seem to be not so bad in the world. You look around, you know, not so bad. But what has happened that is so terrible is we've been desensitized as a race. Desensitized. I mean, the stuff that is constantly bombarded and through the media and entertainment and all this. I mean, if I think back when I was young, if I saw any of that, it would have freaked me out. Completely freaked me out. Still does. But you know, I was horrified. I'd recoil in horror. And yet nowadays, it's nothing. We've been desensitized to extreme depravity, extreme brutality, extremely terrible situations, so that we kind of just say, oh, okay, the whole world, civilization collapses, there's all these barbaric stuff going on, etc. We say, well, this is just like in the movies that I'm used to. This looks like a TV show that I'm used to watching. Or they'll say, oh, you know, this looks like a video game that I'm used to playing. We've all been desensitized to it. So it's easy to push us into situations that we've been desensitized to. Where if we hadn't been desensitized, we'd say, whoa, 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 no, 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 and we'd back away from it. There are games within games within games, you know. It seems like everybody's getting gamed. It's like mirages here, mirages within mirages within mirages. And what you need to do is go to where safety really is. Instead of trying to figure out one mirage after another mirage, just say, hey, all of existence is a mirage. So why do you need to catalog it and categorize it? You don't need to. There's no need to categorize existence to catalog it. None. None. Zero. When you get reacquainted with reality, there won't be a single thing that you remember about existence. Nothing. You won't, nothing about existence will you take with you. Nothing at all, zero. So why do you need to spend time cataloging it and categorizing it? Oh, there's all these different levels, all these different mirages, all these different tricks, and all this stuff. It's a waste of time, severe waste of time. Who's doing what? You will not carry a single thing. When you get to reacquaint yourself with reality, you will entirely forget about existence as if it never was. No lesson you ever learned here has any applicability to reality. None. So, again, look only for the big picture. Look only for the really big picture, the Passover principle, that let the whole scenario pass you over. Find yourself in a loss-free place or realm. Find yourself in paradise. That is the big picture. Find that perfect reflection of reality. Find that perfect mirror. Find that unconditional love, which could care less about cataloging or categorizing anything, that overlays everything inherently, automatically, everything equally. It's not the slightest bit real. Interested in cataloging or categorizing anything or defining anything about existence. Drop it all. In other words, go in that direction towards dropping it all. Go in that direction. Go in that, be attracted to that, because that's what you really want. If you continue to pursue what you think you want, you're going to run into the buzzsaw. You're going to run into angry youth. Okay. And like I said, they're not angry without a reason. They're not just haters, you know. They're not angry without a reason. Because, you know, the debt is unsustainable. And what we have done through generations of entitlement, you know, is run up this terrible situation. Thinking, hey, let's build a utopia here. Everybody's entitled to all this stuff. And we'll just, you know, put it on credit in the future. Well, at some point those bills come due, or the system collapses. And the young people see, hey, it's going to collapse anyway in 20 years. Why not collapse it now? See, that's their reasoning. Why should they wait, you know, 20 years of working their butts off, slaving, stressing out on meds, energy drinks, just to give the older people another 20-year free ride? And then the whole thing's going to collapse anyway. It makes no sense to them whatsoever, right? They're going to say, oh my gosh, it's going to collapse anyway. Why should I do that? Why should I stress myself out and burn myself out to give these older people a free ride? And then the whole thing collapses on me and I get nothing. They say, why don't we collapse it now? And we got a chance 20 years to redo the whole thing, to make a new civilization where maybe we can then, in our older years, have a good life. I mean, it's simple math, isn't it? Simple math. And I can't say that I fault them. Certainly, I don't want this outcome at all. But on the other hand, I'm not going to be one who, you know, be a hater, you know, and say, I've got to see the writing on the wall, you know. It's just, it's simple math. Because that's the situation they're in. They can either work like maniacs on energy drinks and take all sorts of antidepressants and drugs to give the baby boomers 20-year free ride to the grave, and then at that point the whole thing collapses around them and they have nothing and they got no way to retire themselves and at all. In other words, they're up a creek without a paddle. Do that or collapse it now and rebuild a new situation that's more beneficial to them when they're older. You know, if you were young, what would you choose? You know, that's the question. If you were in their shoes, what would you choose? So I'm just seeing the mathematics that they're faced with, and then seeing, you know, how they're going to put that equation and what answer does that equation give them? What do they arrive at? And they're probably going to say, hey, you know, let's at least give ourselves a chance. There's one way, there's no chance. This other way, at least we have a fighting chance. And the older people, they're not going to wipe out their retirements, wipe out their free ride to the grave. So they're not going to make the necessary sacrifices and cuts and do all. They're not going to do it. They're not doing it. And it's too late already. No 60-year-old senator, you know, is going to wipe out retirement benefits and all the stuff for the older people. And it doesn't work that way. So politically, it's not going to get accomplished. It's too late already. It has not been accomplished. And just the numbers, see, you can't escape the numbers. You cannot escape it. So again, the young people are faced with a choice, you know, and the older people are hoping. I hope you decide to give us 20-year free ride to the grave and sacrifice yourselves for us, okay? We hope you do that. You should do that, right? That's what older people are hoping. We're hoping that, right? Younger people are going to say, hey, no way. So I'm just reading the younger people's minds and their attitudes and realize they're not going to do that. They're very ruthless. I mean, their hearts are hardened. They're ruthless. They're saying, no way. Not going to take advantage of me like that. It's true. They're not patsies. You know, they're not going to be patsies. They're not going to be fools. The younger people are nobody's fools. That's how I read them. And they mean business. You know, they mean business. And so, of all our begging and pleading, please give us a free ride to the grave. We deserve it, you know, all this. And they're going to say, ah, no, you just piled all this debt on our shoulders unconscionably. And, you know, it's time to pay the piper. And we have to do it sometime. So we got to do it now. It's not that they're haters. It's that they realize the math. Either it's going to collapse later on their shoulders and give them nothing, or it can be collapsed now and give them a fighting chance. And they just, the math, you know, to them is inescapable, saying, hey, you know, sorry, you know, but, you know, it's got to stop somewhere. And it's better that it stops now than later, because otherwise we get nothing. You know, we get the short end of the stick entirely. And why? That's how they look at it. So they have a deaf ear to older people. That's what I found out. Their awareness, their openness, they're closed to the voices of older people. They are closed down. They're already shut down to them. I've been testing this out for a long time. I'm kind of surprised. Like, wow. They're closed-minded. They're closed to the voice of older people because they know that elder people are going to come to them begging, saying, don't do this, don't do this. Take care of us. Please take care of us, you know. And again, they don't want that guilt feeling to get to them. They've already decided we're going to reject the pleas of the older people, we're going to reject those pleas because we have to do this now. Sacrifice, you know, a couple generations of older people. Hey, life is tough. Life is not fair. That is their attitude, right? Their attitude is, hey, life is not fair. Life is very tough. What can we do? You know, you're out of luck. Just, you happen to be in the crosshairs of history. Sorry. It's not our fault. You know, we got to do what we got to do. That is their attitude, right? We got to do what we got to do. Sorry. So, in seeing all of this and being aware that all this is going to happen, I certainly have been planning for that. You know, I don't have any financial plans at all in this world to retire because I realize it's not going to be possible. The system's going to be collapsed. And, you know, you'll be put in camps and starved to death, basically. You'll die from stress and the diseases that you get, and, you know, sorry. And again, hard to blame them, you know. We are in the crosshairs of history. It's not really their fault. It is the fault of the idea that we chose of trying to be prime creator. That is where the fault lies. It doesn't lie in the younger generations. It's not their fault. They are simply, again, caught up in this whole scenario of existence. And we are caught, the older people are caught in the crosshairs of history. And they're going to do what they got to do. And we're out of luck. So, in being aware of all this ahead of time, I said, okay, how can I help everyone, but especially my generation, older people, with this situation? And younger people too. Some of these younger people don't want to be that way too, right? They don't want to collapse the whole situation and sacrifice the older people. So they don't want to be part of that. So those people too, who don't want to be part of this, I'm saying, isn't there an alternative? And I believe there is. I believe there's an alternative. I've been working on it my entire life. There's an alternative. There's a way to sidestep this scenario. And I'm dedicated to that, which is why I'm not playing golf today. Although there still is time, but probably will not do it because I have to keep going on this. I say the Passover principle. I believe there'll be a way to literally find yourselves translated into another realm. The lost free realm is what I call it, which reflects what you really want. It's a reflection of what you really want. And then you get used to that. You say, ah, I remember what I really want. This is great. I literally believe that this will take place and is possible. And this is what Jesus told us about 2,000 years ago, that he's returning to this planet during the what he calls the end times, during this collapse of civilization that has been foreseen. And he will take all those who want to go dwell where the dwelling place he has made for us. That is, he will take us all there. In other words, translate us into that realm where we can dwell there. And it's not a religious thing like only Christians can go this. No, it's a thing about going to where, being attracted to what you really want. So it makes no difference what your background is, what your beliefs, ideology, all this stuff. You can be an atheist, you can be a Jew, Islam, Hindu, Buddhist, Christian, agnostic, anything at all. But if you say, I want to be attracted back to what I really want, you will then be translated. And you will find yourself in the lost free realm, and you will find that they say, oh my God, this is what I really want. Now I'm starting to remember what I really want. It's simply remembering what you really want, because you realize nothing is suffering loss of any kind. Nothing has ever suffered loss of any kind here. Oh my gosh. And again, I have been there. I'm speaking from direct experience. I did spend a little time in the lost free realm. My spirit did, while I was sleeping. Somehow my spirit was translated into that realm temporarily. I experienced it, and my reaction, I know exactly what it's like. And it was like, oh my gosh. Nothing here has ever suffered any loss of any kind. No damage, no harm, no sickness, no death, no loss of any kind. And I said, oh my gosh, this is what I really want. This is it. This is what I really want. I'm remembering reality just like that. It's there. That realm is there. And those who are pursuing loss, padding their resume of loss, of course, they're not attracted to that. They can't see it. because there's no loss there, no opportunity for them. Their perception can't even see it, unaware that it's there, unaware. They will continue on with the scenario of loss, which will be great loss in, coming up in the future. Again, don't stick around. Don't be a hater. Don't be a, you know, judge the young people. I don't judge them. They're doing what the math tells them to do. You know, it's a no-brainer for them, right? And existence is dancing its dance of loss and destructivity and trauma and harm. That's what its purpose is, to build up this resume of loss, even against our will, supposedly. Loss against our will. I mean, you know, the ultimate padding of our resume is for situations to take place that we don't want, all this loss to collapse around us and everything terrible. And we say, oh, we can't stand this. Because then we'll go to the Prime Creator and say, look, you may not want reality to be changed, but look at this evidence that we're able to change what doesn't want to be changed. We're able to inflict loss on what doesn't want to suffer loss. Therefore, we're going to inflict it upon you if you don't make a deal and change reality on your own initiative. We'll force it on you. So, of course, the loss that we're pads our resume, that the strongest pad is loss we don't want. So we have all this older generation, billions of people on this planet now. And they don't want civilization to collapse. They don't want all this stuff to happen to them. And yet it's going to be forced upon them, you know, supposedly against their will, you see. But when you buy into this idea of trying to change reality, your will is to pad the resume of loss. So it's not really happening against your will. Even though you hate it, you think in the long run you'll get the leverage over the Prime Creator by doing this. But certainly on the superficial levels, definitely not what you want. Definitely against your what you think is your will. Okay. Again, doing this outside, people are moving around. So what I would like to see is everybody be translated into the loss-free realm. The young and the old. Because, you know, I don't think that the young people want to do this. It's simply, it's the lesser of two evils for them. That's, you know, that's how they see it, and I can't argue with that at all. It's the lesser of two evils for them. And of course, the older people don't want it to happen at all. No way. So, I'd like to see all the young people and all the older people and all the middle-aged people translated into the loss-free realm. That is what I want for everybody. Because everyone is caught up in the dynamics of existence, which is to generate this loss, especially against your will. Nobody really wants it to happen. I don't think the young people really want to cut off the older people. The older people certainly don't want to be cut off. Nobody really wants this to happen, but they see it as a lesser of two evils. They feel that they're boxed into this, because the very purpose of existence is to box us into these situations where all this sacrifice happens, you know, to pad our resume of loss so that we can then put the pressure on Prime Creator to change reality for us. Yeah, we don't have to do that because reality can't be changed. All this is futile, is a waste of time, gets us nowhere. And so even though we've boxed ourselves into this situation where it seems like, you know, inevitable loss against our will is going to happen, we can also choose, hey, to give up this effort to change reality, which to be attracted to what we really want, which is reality as it is. And that a willingness to be attracted to reality is the Passover principle, where we will be then automatically be translated into this loss-free realm, this paradise realm. That can happen for everyone. Every single person on this face of this planet can be translated. Everyone. And it's my hope and will that everyone is translated, but they must be willing to be attracted to what they really want. Okay. Very great. I'm going to end this video here, and perhaps later on I'll make another one. So we're advancing the narrative in a tremendous way here. I mean, this is just fabulous. The progress just in this video has just been breathtaking, you know, for me. To see the whole picture now so clearly, it's just fantastic. So I hope this video has been helpful for you too. All right, very great. We'll end it now.